Our third talk before lunch is by Christophe Gilliot, who is the director of the Historique Medievale at Azincourt itself. He is responsible for its special commemorations this year, and he has carried out many original research aspects into the records of the towns of the Pas-de-Calais and their links to the battle, as well as into the commemoration of 1915. And could I say that the Agincourt 600 Commemorative Fund is funding two groups of British soldiers to go to Azincourt on the 25th of October to join with French colleagues to commemorate not only the 600th anniversary of the battle, but the centenary of the 500th anniversary when British and French troops met together on the battlefield in 1915. Christophe, thank you.
First, I want to thank our Professor Anchory and the Society of Antiquaries for the invitation. And one more time, thank you to the Professor Curie for the translation of my presentation. I apologize for my English, which is pretty average, and my terrible French accent. We commemorate this year the 600th anniversary of the famous Battle of Agincourt. My research on the battle and its historiography, to my surprise, showed that we are not the only ones to commemorate the Battle of Agincourt. In fact, there are almost 100 years during the First World War, French and English forgot the old wars of war to commemorate an important event or to share a history, the Battle of Agincourt. This commemoration was permitted by the passion of an infantry commander, Paul Pinault, but also by the presence of numerous British troops on the soil of Pas-de-Calais. Through this paper, I will try to explain what were the commemoration of October 1915 and try to present to you the presence, the English presence around Agincourt during the First World War. But first, let's start with a quick overview of the First World War in Pas-de-Calais. So, the communes of the Pas-de-Calais were all affected, either directly or indirectly, by the First World War. The front covered more than 2,000 settlements, of which ones, such as Lens or Béthune, were almost completely razed to the ground. And there were not a single town or village in the department which did not grieve for its deaths. You can see here a plan which presents the line of fire in Pas-de-Calais. So Agincourt is around here. Here you have the city of Lens, which was very important for the coal mines, which represent a very important energy for the French or the Germans during the First World War. And you have here the famous city of Liévin, and one more time, very important for the coal mines. And finally, you can see here, we are around, in fact, close to Arras. Arras is nobody here. Arras, which was, in fact, the prefecture of Pas-de-Calais. Today, the traces of the war are particularly obvious in the department. The frontier zone, around 30 kilometers wide, was the most seriously affected, especially around Bapaume and Arras, where, come 1918, there was virtually nothing left. Not a single street, house or church. In the Pas-de-Calais, we can identify three main phases of the war. And these phases appear with these lines that you can see here on this card. From August to December 1914, The department was the theater of which experienced mobile war as the Germans advanced towards Paris through Belgium. After the outcome of the Battle of the Marne at the beginning of September, the German offensive, known as To the Sea, was launched. Each of the protagonists was faced with the same problem. Loss of life and materials was substantial, but it had proven impossible to make any meaningful breakthrough in enemy lines. There was there before only one option, to take the enemy from the rear in order to surround them. The high command of both sides withdrew men all along the lines in order to ensure adequate food supplies for troops during this action. During this phase of the war, the front moved very rapidly. After being localized between 20 and 30 September at the Somme, fighting reached the area of Saint-Paul by the beginning of December 1914. For several weeks later, conflict broke out so that the front could not stabilize. The first Battle of Ypres, October-December 1914, was a victory for the Allies and stopped the German advance. As a result, the front was frozen and the protagonist dug in, creating a stand of weaving a system of trench which ran from the North Sea to the Swiss frontier. This was the beginning of a war of positions. Between January 1915 and March 1918, there was next to no change in the front. Incapable of gaining advantage over each other, the protagonists focused instead on consolidating their positions by managing their network of trench so that any advance by the enemy was made impossible. We also see new ways of fighting, such as gas flamethrowers. This was the beginning of the war of attrition. In this period, the front crossed the Pas-de-Calais from the north to the south, passing through Lens, Liévin, Arras, and Bapaume. In 1915, the war in Pas-de-Calais was in state of stalemate. 1916 was characterized by the arrival of a new army from other Allied countries to repress the French troops mobilized for a terrible Battle of Verdun, which lasted from February to June and cost 1 million lives. The front in the Pas-de-Calais was now held by British, Canadian, and Australians, along with a few regiments of French infantry territorials. The following year, 1917, was marked by the Battle of Vimy Ridge and Arras, places of real carnage. In that year, the Russian Revolution and the deposition of Tsar Nicholas II liberated the Germans from the Eastern Front. Further reinforcements were brought back from following the peace signed with the Soviets at the beginning of 1918. The Battle of the River Lys, won at the end of the day by the Alliés, provide a good illustration of the phenomenon. How took the superior numbers of the Germans seriously damage the Allied positions, the latter did not collapse. From August 1918, the front was driven eastward. The 100 years, the final attack conducted by the Alliés, with in particular the Second Battle of Arras, and the capture of the Canal du Nord in September-October 1918 forced the German army to retreat and the Kaiser's regime to surrender, putting an end to 4 long years of war. Here you have an idea of what were looking like main cities of Pas-de-Calais at the end of 1918. You can see here the city of Lens, which was famous for the coal mines, normally a rich city, which was destroyed at 98%. Small villages around Arras, you can see that the small villages were destroyed too. This is a picture from a private collection, took in 1915. Here you can see a lot of English injured by gas experimented, so in Belgium for the first time. One other picture of the city of Lens in 1918. This one is coming from the Imperial War Museum. There is a lot of pictures and photographs in this museum. Arras, 1917. And the horrors of war. So, like what you can discover in 1918, it was very common in Pas-de-Calais, especially around Arras and Lens. So in Pas-de-Calais, the First World War had a devastating effect on the eastern half of the department, which from crossing northwest to south east through Glos-Angoël, Lens-Liévin, the area of Artois between Lorette and Rumi, circling Arras on the east and continuing towards the Somme and La Pomme. For all this time, the village of Agincourt in English, lay in a French zone about 40 kilometers from the front. Therefore, the village and its neighborhood were spared destruction. However, the positions of the area between the western front and the sea guaranteed that the area of the Seven Valley Ternois was always a zone of intense activity. So you can see here the Seven Valley Ternois. You can see that we are close to the coast and close to the front, which was approximately here. Agincourt is over here. Also, 40 kilometers from the front, the villages of Agincourt, Maisoncelles, Trincourt, Blangy-sur-Ternoise, and the hamlet of Bucamp were on many occasions places to rest for the French and British troops who had passed up to 6 months at the front. The French soldiers of 1914 and 1918, did not spend all his time in the trenches. Generally, an infantry regiment containing around 1,300 men was at the front for about 6 months. The regiment was divided into several battalions, which rotated, passing on average 12 days actually on the front line. Southern battalion occupied the trench of the second line and overstood southern back in reserve. Regular change arounds from the front to the rear were organized. As a result, the soldier was almost in constant movement. He marched, he dug, he fought, marched again, rested. Then came Lee, which the common soldier called le tourniquet. In French, we called it le tourniquet. The soldiers waited for it impatiently since it offered them the rest they so much deserved. The troops at the front left in order to be billeted in village well away from the front lines. Once in these rear positions, the first day of rest were given up to sleeping and using the showers, which freed the soldiers from fleas and scabies. They took the opportunity to disinfect their uniforms, have a good look at their equipment, and to carry out any repairs. In order to keep up discipline and morale, much of the rest period was given up to training. Drill, parade, practicing discipline and morale, shooting, training with new weapons. Opportunity was also taken to reward the veterans by giving up decoration and also to integrate any new recruit group to compensate for losses. So you can see here at a picture which has been taken in, I think it's in 1918, at Blangy-sur-Ternoise, at 2 kilometers from Agincourt, you can see an English canteen. We never found the house where the canteen was. Probably the house was destroyed after the First World War. A pictures that I like a lot. You can see English soldiers gathering between Agincourt and Azincourt on the battlefield, so in 1918. Here you can see English and French soldiers discussing close to an aircraft gun. So this was took to between Fruges and Azincourt. So the 3rd Battalion of Chasseurs à pied, remember. From the 13th of September to the 22nd of October 1915, the 3rd Battalion of Chasseurs à pied, so the Chasseurs à pied are elite soldiers. So the 3rd Battalion of Chasseurs à pied, commanded by the captain and in 1915 commander, so Paul Pinault, found the German into the woods of Ersin-Coupigny, not far from Bruyères-la-Bruissière. Also in this zone, the German invaders has been driven back from June 1915 onwards. Life in the frontline trenches was not less challenging for the soldiers of the battalion who had held the positions for 3 weeks. You can see here the plan, who has been made by the commander Pinault, Paul Pinault himself. So, in the official diary of the 3rd Battalion Regiment, you can see the organization of the French trenches, so close to Ersin-Coupigny. Ersin-Coupigny, which is very famous in the Pas-de-Calais because this is probably one of the most deathfully places in the department. So you can see the commander Paul Pinault, so who was the commander of the 3rd Battalion of Chasseurs à pied. So Paul Pinault is a very interesting man. He is the commander of the 3rd Battalion, but it's him who organized in 1915 the Agincourt commemoration. He was born in a family in Bretagne, in fact, and his father was a teacher, an history teacher. So maybe that explains what he made in 1915. Paul Pinault enlisted in October 1893. Because of his studies, he quickly became an important official. So he finished his military career in 1921 as lieutenant colonel. Paul Pinault is a very famous soldier because he was a knight of the Legion d'honneur, which is a very important French medal. So he was a knighted official of the Legion d'honneur in 1920. He was an officer of the public school. He was an officer of different orders in Japan, Belgium, and Tunisia. The 22 of October, the battalion left Ersin-Coupigny at 5:30 a.m. and arrived at Trincourt at 6:30 p.m. the same evening. The commanders installed themselves in the Chateau de Trincourt, where the pioneers, machine gun, and Legion officers were billeted. The 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th, and 6th companies were billeted in Maisoncelles along with the tank and supply column. The 23rd and 24th October were given up to rest and training. The French troops were trained by British instructors from the 1st Dragoons in the operation of the French catapult, of the trench catapult, sorry, which enabled hand grenades to be sent over longer distance. On 25th of October, the commanding officer has planned a ceremony in honor of the 5th anniversary of the Battle of Agincourt. But rain prevented it going ahead and it was postponed to the next day. On 26th of October, officials of the 3rd Battalion of Chasseurs à Pied welcomed the British general who commanded the 1st Dragoon Cavalry Division stationed at Fruges and his chief officer on the battlefield in order to honor all who fell in the engagement on the 25th of October 1415. This symbol of peace and fraternity of two people who had been bitter enemies in 1415 but who were not united against a common enemy attracted the attention of the French and British journalists. They have left us a witness account of the commemoration on 26th of October 1915 and we can also draw up on the detailed journal of the 3rd Battalion itself. So, you can see here an extract from the newspaper L'Illustration, dated for the 27th of November 1915. You can see here the Château de Trincourt. The Château de Trincourt is an early 18th century castle, built at 2 kilometers. From Agincourt, so it's one of the most important castles in the Ternois Sète Valley. The owners of the castle are the family de Chabot Trincourt, which still exists today. We can see here in the garden of the castle the 3rd Battalion presenting arms to the British officers from the 1st Dragoon. Here on this newspaper, you can see on this picture, sorry, you can see the commandant Paul Pinault explaining the battle to the English officer and to the troops, because you can see that the soldiers got paper too. It's very interesting to compare, in fact, the newspaper because you have here a very big article from L'Illustration. This big article has been written by the Commandant Pinault, where in this article he presents the importance for the French and the English to commemorate this the Battle of Agincourt, this event of our common history. He insists on the fact that there is nothing to see between the wars between French and English and between French and Germans, because he said in his article that the Germans are not fighting with honor, they are rude, etc., etc. Here you have the English newspaper, so L'Illustration in 1918, that Professor Curie will send to me the picture. You can see that the article is shorter, but the essential is here in the title, in fact, Hopefuls, Brothers in Arms. So the journalists insist on the fact that these two armies, these two countries, which were enemies, are no friends. And here you have an extract from the diary of Paul Pinault, so where he explained what he explained to the soldiers and the British officer. So he explained what were the Indigenous War. You can see here Guerre de Cent Ans. Of course, French, he talks about Joan of Arc. But it's also interesting to see that in this document, he explained the importance of the stakes of wood the day of the battle, and he is making a comparison between the stakes that you have in front of the trench, of the trenches. So it's very interesting to read. In 1916, the British relief. For the 175 Brigade of Infantry territorial, Agincourt became the final place of rest before the Battle of Verdun. So a territorial regiment was made up of men still capable of fighting, but deemed to be too old to fight in the front line. In August 1914, this applied for all those born between 1875 and 1880. None of the less, because of big losses in the trenches, the youngest of this group, Nickel made les Pépères. Pépères, you can translate it like grandfathers. So, were sent to the lines of fire in order to compensate for the enormous losses of the first month of the conflict. Territorial soldiers were, in theory, given to more static activities, which were less exposed to danger. The sort of activities were for veterinary work, requisitions, administrations, interpreters, highway service, health corps, gendarmerie, gathering of material, arranging burials, maintaining trenches, matching gunners. Installed at Agincourt, the Brigade Territoriale was soon joined by the 1st Battalion of the 81st Regiment of Infantry and the 1st Battalion of the 92nd Regiment of Infantry. They were distributed as follows. The Central Command, the Compagnie en rang is the flag bearers and musicians of the regiment. So, the Company of Machine Gunners were at Agincourt. The cyclists at Agincourt, the horse and blacksmiths at Agincourt, the train de combat, it's people in fact who are sure that you have munitions in the army. The 2nd battalion at Bellancourt and the 10th regiment of cuirassiers at Blangy-sur-Ternoise. The 2 weeks of being built at Agincourt were divided by exercises, medal ceremonies. On 17 February 1916, General Sébastien Zerday received the cross of the commander of the Legion d'honneur on the battlefield at Agincourt. Allocated to the Ministry of War, he left Agincourt for Paris on 20 February, being replaced by the Colonel Boucher. So you can see on these photographs taken in 1916, the General Zardel, that you can see here, and the Colonel Boucher standing on the Agincourt battlefield, not far from the cavalry here. Another time you can see the General Zardel, the Colonel Boucher, the Capitaine Lamotte and the photographer here in front of the today's presbytery. It's the home of the parish priest. So here, in front of the church, in fact. And here, a group of soldiers having their photo taken in front of the church of Agincourt in February 1916. So it's very interesting to see that for people who went to Agincourt, they know in fact this location. Today, this is the place in fact of the village where you can park your cars. And from the Middle Ages to 1960, this was what we called in French a mare. And it's very interesting because in front of the church, the mar was in front of the between the church and between the old castle, which was not a castle but only a fortified tower. We have a representation of 1604, which represents just a stone tower, no more. So the Sainte-Vallée-Ternois was the base for the English behind the lines. Even from 1914 and the first action of the war, British forces were rapidly strengthened by fresh troops coming from the wall of the British Empire. The Pas-de-Calais, and especially the territory of the Seven Valley Ternois, became a huge open air barracks through which passed thousands of men. English, Welsh, Scottish, alongside Canadians, Chinese, Indians, Australians, New Zealanders, Gurkha, Sikh, Kafir, or even Chinese coolies. All men had a single goal, the victory of the Allies. After a rather perfunctory training because the needs were so great, the soldiers departed from the front in Artois and the Somme. Commercial ports were taken over for military purposes. Every day, thousands of tons of merchandise, supplies and arms were landed on the quay of Boulogne or Calais and strong transport via Hedin before being distributed across the wall of Ouharia. A complex road, river and rail network took all the materials towards the combat zone. In order to cope with the sheer volumes, the highway between Hedin and Etaples was doubled. From October 1916, the heavy branch machine gun corps had its main base at the Château of Bernicourt. 1,200 troopers, 27 officers and 500 Chinese laborers were divided up between the neighboring villages, Blangy-sur-Ternoise, Tilly-Capelle, Humières, Éclime, Sautricourt, Pierrefonds, Hernicourt, Rolancourt and Montchiquelieu. And finally, Hérin, where a factory of tanks Mark IV was established. To cater for the needs of the tank corps, the valley of the Ternoise was covered by temporary barracks, tents, workshops, laundries, all supplied by more than a dozen highway lines. The Pas-de-Calais, and particularly the Seven Valley Ternoise, became the lungs of the British Army. Wounded men taken from the combat zone were initially looked after in the Pas-de-Calais, for instance at Blangy-sur-Ternoise, where the hospice was established in St. Bertha's Abbey, was transformed into an hospital. In that location, were treated the more seriously wounded, who were also taken to Hedin in the British Military Hospital and Saint-Paul-sur-Ternoise. Those who could not be taken by ship to England threaded the hospital all along the Channel. To illustrate this, 20 or so hospitals were established in the Etaples sector where 20,000 men could be cared for. Many soldiers died there. Today, the sacrifice is recalled by the Etaples Military Cemetery, which has almost 11,500 graves, of which 658 are of four Germans. This is the largest Commonwealth war grave in France. So here you can see a very interesting picture, in fact, of the Hérin factory. So Hérin is at 5 kilometers from Agincourt, and you can see here British and Chinese laborers working on the tank marquard motors. The tank marquard here always the same at Hérin. Here at Hedin, so you can see French and British soldiers talking together on the Place d'Armes at Hedin. Here you can see the Royal Engineers, so building highways close to Hedin. Here the English Military Hospital of Hedin in 1917. And now we talk about the first, the Château Tramcourt. Tramcourt, a château for English distinguished visitors. Always keen to support and encourage the soldiers, King George V, who was also Emperor of India, did not hesitate to go to the front in person, even getting quite close to the actual fighting. In 1915, he visited his troops engaged in the Second Battle of Artois at Arras. In 1916, he inspected British troops engaged in the Battle of the Somme. In 1917, he and his wife, Queen Mary, within the format of his official visit to the Western Front, spent 11 days in France and Belgium, meeting soldiers at the front, but also in villages behind the lines. More than simply reviving the morale of the troops, severely tested during the carnage of Rimini and Arras, this visit also had a strong political significance. Only a few weeks earlier, John V, cousin of the Kaiser Wilhelm II, had faced an escalation of anti-German feeling in England. The king had to change his family name, abandoning Saxe-Coburg and Gotha for the name of Windsor. It was therefore important for him to show his break with Germany and his full personal engagement in the struggle against his cousin at a time where mutinies of Allied soldiers were becoming more numerous. So here you can see an overview of the Chateau de Trincourt. You have, for example, some English marine officer at Trincourt in 1917. So most of these distinguished visitors were coming to see and to visit the Hera tank factory, which was very, very new for the period. Here you can see the Duke Arthur and his son, so at Trincourt. So Trincourt, which was initially requisitioned by the French army and later by the British, the Chateau Trincourt was occupied throughout the First World War. From 1916, when the British took responsibility for the defense of the wall of the Western Front in the department, the Chateau became the place where many soldiers and politicians stayed. In fact, the Chateau de Trincourt was considered as the second headquarters, the main headquarters was at Montreuil-sur-Mer. From the 3rd to the 14th of July 1917, George V and Queen Mary undertook an official visit to the Western Front, visiting several locations in Belgium and along the Somme, hospital as well as the tank factory at Erin. The monarch, accompanied by Albert I, King of Belgium, and his wife, Queen Elizabeth, came to stay at the Chateau de Trincourt for one night. They no doubt appreciated opportunities of work in the park, as well as a visit to the Museum of the Souvenir of the War, Musée des Souvenirs de Guerre, which has been placed there. The chateau seems to have been particularly liked by the royals. On 20 September, during a visit to the Canadian troops, Prince Arthur, Duke of Connaught, and the Strathearn, Governor of Canada, uncle of John V, spent some time at the Chateau de Trincourt with his son, Arthur Jr. You can see the picture here, and here you can see the picture of the George V, Queen Mary and their son Edward of Wales at Trincourt in 1917. Here, walking in the gardens with the Queen and the King of Belgium, Albert I and Elizabeth. And here a picture of the Museum of War Memorials at Trincourt, which is amazing, yes, German. It's interesting to see that in the Imperial War collection you have an English helmet which was presented at Trincourt, which is now in the Imperial War Museum collection. Here you can see soldiers from the Fiji Island, so saluting the King of England. The 13th of August 1816, so one day before a tentative of assassination of the King John V at Trincourt. In fact, when wanting to be present at the last push against the Germans back into their homelands, George V came to the front and chose the Chateau de Trincourt as his base. Informed to this, no doubt, by the spy, the Germans launched a dozen aircraft to bombard the Chateau de Trincourt whilst the king was there. On the evening of 14 August 1918, the inhabitants of Trincourt saw an aerial battle. German pilots looked at the target and then let loose their bombs. But military aviation was still in its fancy, and the pilots missed their target. The Chateau de Trincourt was spared, but the village of Ambricourt, about 1 kilometer away, suffered of the attack. a dozen bombs hit it. By a miracle, there were no casualties or significant damage since the bomb landed in an area of pasture and other fields. This misfortune earned the village royal honors, and a special Thanksgiving, Fête de la Reconnaissance in French, was organized on 15th of August 1919 to thank God for having saved the village. Thank you.